For me, democracy basically is one system that we have borrowed, or we borrowed from other nationalities. And as a system that we borrowed, definitely you expect to have some issues here and there. But for me, what we do by observing, or in observing the Democracy Day in our own country, Nigeria, is more of a symbolic thing. Symbolic because, yes, we have come a long way as a nation. Yes, we have come a long way politically and democratically. And there is that need for us to now maybe put out one day out and see how Nigerians will reflect back on the journey so far. I think that is just the symbolical reasons why the government decided to have this day called Democracy Day. Of course, there are issues. It used to be 29th of April, 29th of May. And for of course, very obvious reasons, the President of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, Muhammadu Buhari, and with the mandate of most of all who are stakeholders in the ruling in APC, decided to now reverse it to the June 12th has been the date for Democracy Day. I don't have to discuss much about that, but you all know why, for political reasons, and based on what the history have for us, definitely the choice of June 12th to be the Democracy Day for Nigeria, I think is a very good one, well-informed decision, and it has also helped us as a nation to continue to be together. The history of June 12 is one sad history that you can never forget. And if members of the western part of the country, citizens of the western part of the country, especially the politically minded people, will continue to look at other people from other ends or divide of the country, reflecting on some of these sad notes of the retrogressive decision taken against the mandate and the will of the people, as far as June 12 mandate was concerned, I think that will to a great extent put Nigeria together. It will also to a great extent provide a direction, political direction, and of course a democratic direction for our own country, Nigeria, believing that yes, this is one and united country, and whatever affects one part of the country will definitely affect the other part of the country. I think it is on the basis of this self-recognition and self-identification that I believe you look at Nigeria as if it is a country of magic. Magic in the sense that you find one trouble or the other bedeviling the country, and you hear people loud enough shouting. But because of this kind of political bond, because of this history we have come through, Nigeria continues to exist as one and indivisible country. Some of these things that may be seen as symbolic, like I said, some of these things that may be seen as merely rhetorical, have a great sense of role that they play in keeping us as a united nation. And if you look at what we have made so far, of course the journey started with rough edges. The journey also came through a lot of issues, challenges and whatever, political, democratic and other things. Some of them even have to do with the economic systems we run, the issue of restructuring. So many challenges, so many issues, so many people asking for restructuring our federal coexistence, asking to devolve us more to the state. These are all issues that are naturally existing within a system like our own. Nigeria being not only a federal system of government, but a country that has within it diverse ethnicities, diverse social and cultural background. And you also remember how we came in as a nation, the history of our amalgamation of the Federal Republic of Nigeria, the Southern and the Northern Protectorate, the role played by Lord Lugard to bring us together. So you must also agree with me that definitely issues like this will come up one way or the other. And it's not for us to avoid the issues. When there are issues that are natural, when there are issues that are realistic, when there are issues that are of concern to us as a nation, don't run away from them. Face them, put yourselves together, look at the way forward, look at the way and manner we can now maybe be able to not only navigate, but to be able to champion a cause that will get out of some of these bedeviling issues in a manner whereby each and every one of us will be a happy component of the federation we call Nigeria. So for me, for us to achieve the essence of our being together, for us also to achieve the fruits of what we call democratic governance, we must also have to democratically look at some of these bedeviling issues and review even some of our constitutional agreements, review even some of our territorial coexistence, look at the issue of maybe restructuring the country from the economic point of view, or restructure its political structure, the narrative of the political structure we have as a nation. Look at them. We don't have to necessarily disintegrate. The country can continue to exist as long as we agree to terms that are mutually beneficial to every component of this country, of the system. In a situation whereby there is injustice, in a situation whereby there is a lack of a sense of belonging by some people, then definitely there is cause for us to review. There are so many things that I don't have to open up on the pages or papers or on the screen, but I want to believe that yes, for us to continue to enjoy the dividend of democracy, for us to continue to enjoy the principles of natural democracy, there are a lot of things that we have to review. Thank God we have a government that is not only popular, it's a government that was brought into power by the will of the people. Muhammadu Buhari is one man that everybody respects as an individual. He's one man that mostly, but virtually all Nigerians have confidence in him as a reliable leader, a leader that is not only transparent in the discharge of his responsibility, a leader that is believed world over not to be a corrupt leader. And I think if we cannot use the opportunity of having someone like Buhari to address some of these problems, then definitely we should forget about it. I don't assume, I don't believe we can have any better time to address some of these issues affecting our mutual coexistence as a federation better than this time. This time because you have a leader who has had what you call that military background. You have a leader who took seriously into his own experience to keep Nigeria united even in those days of the civil war. He partook in the civil war. He also supported Nigerian government and made sure that Nigeria did not disintegrate. And here comes the same person now under a democratic session, as being in charge, which means you have in the person of Muhammadu Buhari the faith of the country you call a united Nigeria. You have also in the same personality of Muhammadu Buhari somebody who does not only believe in the coexistence of the country, the territorial integrity and respect for the Nigerian state. In same person, you also have someone who has also taken part in the fight against secession in the so-called civil war time. So for someone now to be in charge under a democratic platform, then definitely Muhammadu Buhari has all it takes to make sure that some of the issues that are bedeviling our peaceful coexistence are addressed. This would be the best time you can ever have to address some of these problems. So in a nutshell, as a member of the House, I'm not speaking, of course, on behalf of the leadership. This is my opinion. I think some of these issues that are real, some of these issues that are factual, some of these issues that need to be addressed in terms of justice and peaceful coexistence, in terms of even carrying along every component of the system, to have that sense of belonging, I think this is the right time for us to come to address them. And obviously you don't have any other window to do that except constituted authorities. And the only constituted authority to go into this kind of discourse is basically the National Assembly. I think this is a very fine idea. And like I've earlier said, nobody should run away from the truth. Yes, we have a lot of issues, controversies, a lot of aggressions, civil and otherwise, and so a lot of suspicion and even speculations around the Nigerian state. And whether you like it or not, as long as we run what we call democracy, we are operating a democratic system of government. This is a system that goes with rules to go by. Then definitely we must have to be guided by the set down rules and objectives of a democratic system. What I'm trying to say in essence is that if we have cause to dialogue, if we have cause to review our terms of agreement even as a nation, you don't have any other option to do that except through the National Assembly. And through the National Assembly we have processes, there are procedures. For instance, at the moment, we have the Constitutional Review Committee ongoing for the Ninth Assembly. It is one big window for every Nigerian to come and submit memoranda, submit his own contribution. What do you think? What do you think we need to review in the Constitution? And if you want us also to hold a special dialogue, that dialogue can only be constitutional and successful if it is channeled through the representatives of the people of the Federal Republic of Nigeria as constituted or as provided for in the Constitution. So the leadership of the National Assembly, of course, we have it as a challenge. The Senate President is there, the Speaker, Right Honorable Femi Bajabiamila, is there, and those of us who are supporting them under the platform of the leadership of the National Assembly today will be very much ready to engage with all the stakeholders. We'll be ready to engage with leaders of various ethnic groups. Let them come and advance to the National Assembly. In some cases, go through some of our standing committees. In some cases, go through our ad hoc committees. For instance, like I've said, I want to repeat with emphasis that the Constitutional Review Committee at the moment is one very big window for every Nigerian, either an individual or a group, to come up and make submissions as to what you want Nigeria to be, or what do we need to review in the code of operations of our operations, in the code of our political operations, or the discharge of our responsibility as per institutions and arms of government. And that can definitely be addressed. But when people just get on the street and begin to call for dialogue, how would you dialogue when the concept of the dialogue you are talking about is not captured in the Constitution of the Federal Republic of Nigeria? That is the only implication. Nigerians should accept the fact that, yes, it's an institutional democracy. It's a democracy that is already in action. We are having a democratic process already ongoing. So for anyone to come up with any other matter outside what is provided for in the Constitution, that is what we call extraneous variable, extraneous factors. And we will not allow extraneous factors to come and bedevil our institutional proceedings. Of course, we need to look at ourselves again. We need to look at the existence of this country as a nation. We also need to look at even our supreme document, the Constitution. But you can only achieve doing that when you operate through the provided procedures, the procedures provided for you by the system we run into. And I want to believe we are doing that, because even by the conduct of the Constitutional Review Committee at the moment, we are very soon going into public hearing. We are very soon going into public hearing. The main committee here at the national level has created subcommittees to go and engage with Nigerians in their various locations, especially in the various states of the Federation. There are subcommittees created by the Constitutional Review Committee, which of course we are now going to engage members of the public at zonal level. In the Northwest alone, we have about 2-3 subcommittees to go and attend to people, listen to them, and also extract from them their own observations, their views, what they think Nigeria should be, and what they think we should have or not to have in the Constitution of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. For instance, I'm going to lead the subcommittee going to sit in Kano on the 1st of June. So many other principal officers will also lead other committees to other zones, other states of the Federation. The aim of this kind of thing is for us to now get closer to the people. Instead of just holding a public hearing here, a general public hearing, for every Nigerian or every stakeholder or every group to come to Abuja to the National Assembly, which will be very cumbersome, it will be unwieldy. So we have now decided to disengage ourselves into subcommittees to get closer to the people, so that not only people from the state, even people from the periphery, people from what you call the localities, can come and advance their own contributions, ideas as to what they think Nigeria should be. What we rather have as a system is that concept or that principle of the learning process. Like I earlier said, this is a system that we borrowed from other nationalities. This is a system we borrowed from abroad. Then definitely the rules of the game must have to be learned with time. And some of these things that are happening, I don't think they're happening because people want to willingly overturn the principles of democracy, but it's because we are taking time to learn. Our own democracy, for instance, I think is about 20 or 22 years old now. And for a democracy that just started in the last 20, 22 years, then definitely you will expect to have some of these kind of interventions. Sometimes, of course, deliberate actions by some people who through the use of their offices will want to undermine one thing or the other. But for, to be specific, with respect to the National Assembly having more powers, I don't think the National Assembly is stripped of any needed power at the moment. We have been given enough powers, of course, to enact laws, enforce those laws, oversight the activities of government, and even when we now come to all, to even to legislation, when you come to make up, come up with a law, the Constitution continued to went further to give the National Assembly extra power that even if the executive or the president, who is the head of the executive, fails to assent to a bill, we can bring that bill and by two-thirds we make it a law.
We've never done it.
It's because of the learning.
That's
what I'm saying. It's because during the NDDC we did, and there is also one other time we did, about twice. But it is all about the learning process. And what we are trying to do in this case is to make sure we look at ourselves as one indivisible government. Of course, we have different functions. The executive has its own function as laid down by the Constitution. The legislature also has its own function, and the judiciary also has its own functions as an arm of government. But we now want to believe that working together on the same page, complementing the efforts of each other, will rather deliver more yields for our people, the dividend of democracy, will rather deliver more effectiveness in terms of governance than fighting one another. But where there is cause for us, for instance, to disagree with the government, especially on a matter that is quite popular or unpopular, is against the will of the people, then definitely we will have no cause whatsoever not to toy the path of the government if it comes up with anything that will definitely go against the will of the people. So the synergy will continue, but we will never agree to synergize with any arm of government at the peril of the interest of the people that we represent. That is why we are called representative of the people. And I want to believe that the way we are going, actually, the executive will be allowed to do the much it could do within the space of their duties, and the legislature also will be allowed, or is being allowed, to do the very much they are expected of as a representative of the people and as lawmakers to make laws that will impact positively on the lives of the people of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. And I also want to say, without any fear of contradiction, that the leadership we have at hand right now of the National Assembly, ably led by the Senate President and the Speaker of the House of Representatives, we have come up with an agenda. And the agenda is for us to actualize even our institutional independence first, to actualize our institutional integrity first as an institution, and now begin to see how we can, as an institution, align with other arms of government to deliver the expectations of our own people. I want to say, without any fear of being quoted, that this National Assembly, especially the Ninth House of Representatives, has outstandingly, it has done some outstanding performance, very outstanding performance, especially in the area of legislation, in the area of being responsive to the calls of our people. We have always been on our feet to make sure that the interest of the people we represent is protected and is never compromised. Secondly, if you look at, for instance, the way we execute some of the programs that we have at our hand, like the constituency projects, for instance, this is one window through which we deliver some semblance of governance to our people, benefits of governance to our people. In the past, it never happened, because in those days when you had the military being in charge, or in those days when you didn't have this window for the constituency projects, then definitely nobody benefits from the activities of government, because you need to have someone in government, maybe as a permanent secretary, maybe someone as a minister, or somebody as a director in a key federal ministry before you begin to see something come into your own constituency. But now, with the array of members who are representing diverse federal constituencies, one way or the other, every financial year, something will definitely be delivered on the table in terms of infrastructural facilities, development in the educational sector, provisions of healthcare delivery system, and even this issue of security with members on ground. Some of our members used to make use of their constituency coffers or constituency envelopes to address some of the security problems in their respective areas. And we also provide a lot of employment, sometimes casual employment, of course. Sometimes you also help to provide even statutory employment in various government agencies and ministries, because as a representative of the people, obviously, people will look forward to you to really finding means of livelihood. And that is what we go through day in, day out. One important thing that Nigerians must note is that, yes, constituency projects are members' projects. Yes, constituency projects are meant to cover the interests of individual members in the National Assembly. But people, Nigerians tend to forget that we don't form an institution here that implements the activities of government. The National Assembly does not have the bureaucratic infrastructure to implement projects of such nature. We only provide statutory provisions in the budget that, oh yes, I need a block of classroom in Dogwa, or I need a hospital in Tudunwada, where I represent. But when it comes to budget, you can only appropriate that money to an existing federal government agency to implement for you. Government does not release funds through members of the House of Representatives to implement constituency projects. Such monies are routed through the normal statutory process of releases of funds to agencies and ministries of government to do that for us. So whatever goes to the ministry is no longer within the purview or control of an individual member. Those ministries are expected to implement those projects in accordance with the terms of operations of every formal ministry of government. And we can only go out like any other project to oversight and ensure what was provided in the budget for a particular project is being implemented to the latter. No more, no less. But the confusion in the society is that, and I think you guys in the media are not helping matters. The confusion
is from the presidency.
No matter what the presidency says, you need to come and hear from the horse's mouth as well. Releases are done by the presidency through the executive arm of government, Ministry of Finance. Implementation of those projects are also done through the executive arm of government, via the Ministry of Finance. Via the relevant ministries and agencies where we domicile those projects in. Then whoever now goes out to say, oh, there is a fire on the mountain on the issue of constituency projects, then you ask him, from where? When you don't release funds through my office, when you don't implement those projects through my office, then if there is any problem, then you should be held responsible to answer, but not us. So I want to assure you, no one member of the House of Representatives has got any business with the implementation of his constituency project. Your only concern or business about that project is for you to domicile your project in an agency of government. And when the government wants to release money through the Ministry of Finance, they don't inject their money or release their money through members' offices. It is those same ministry of government and agencies that will implement such. And even when you talk about sometimes maybe insinuations that, oh, members do recommend contractors to go and do contracts for them, that is not found. That is not, it's not true. It doesn't happen. I have never recommended any contractor to do my project. But of course, when a contractor is given my project, I have to go out with him and make sure that project is located in accordance with my interest and in accordance with where I wanted that project to be located. Because obviously, it has been provided for the benefit of my own people. And it is done under the corpus of what you call constituency project envelope. I hope you can understand that. And this is one of the things members and Nigerians must understand. We are all working towards the same goal. Same goal in the sense that we must work in the larger interest of our people, overall interest of Nigerian people, because we represent them. So I don't think any member will have cause whatsoever to begin either to derail or to divert a project that is provided for the benefit of his own people. And I want to say without any fear of being quoted that the government is quite doing much, is quite doing impressive, especially in terms of funding our constituency projects. Even as at today, as I speak with you, when you are shouting, we are shouting of no funds, no money, the government has tried, shelter-skelter, to be able to fund our capital constituency projects by not less than 25%. 25% funds have been released to agencies of government, and they have already kick-started process of procurement. And these jobs will definitely be awarded, and Nigerians will begin to see a lot of things of benefit. Even with the challenges government is facing, we have not reneged, and the government has not reneged in funding constituency projects and some other basic capital projects that will at the end impact positively on the lives of our people. And that is one of the reasons why we have no reason whatsoever to begin to engage the government into scuffles or into any unnecessarily misunderstanding, where they can afford to support our programs as legislators, they will definitely do. And where we also have cause to support government for them to execute the needed projects for the benefit of our people, then definitely we have no option. Only yesterday, the president presented to us, communicated to the National Assembly, the need for the government to continue to borrow in order to borrow, in order to fund some capital projects and also to be able to undertake some of its obligations. And we had no option than to grant that, to allow that, because we understand that, yes, the country is facing a lot of economic challenges. Some of our windows for revenues and what have you are dwindling. Then the only option for a government of purpose, a purposeful government, is for the government to go beyond the normals, is to go beyond the convention, to still source funds so that we can be able to fund some of these programs, especially programs to do with the security challenges we are facing in the country. For local government, I think we don't have any issue on the table. The Senate and the House of Representatives have concurred and have accepted to give independence, financial autonomy to the local governments. We have also accepted and agreed through a resolution and a legislation that these people should be granted political and financial autonomy. Where the problem is coming is the state assemblies, who are by constitutional provision, they are also a stakeholder, major stakeholder. They have to concur with us by two-thirds of the total number of states' houses of assembly before an amendment or an alteration is made or any constitutional provision is added to the constitution of the Federal Republic of Nigeria. And I think that is where the shoe is pinching, not on our own side. And I think you also have the time to reach out as Nigerians, members of the press, civil society organization, to reach out to the state assemblies on campaign, lobby, to let them understand that having an independent local government will definitely usher in development, and it will also usher in an effective local administration at our local government level, so that local governments can be seen to be functioning and functional at a point whereby everyone will have no cause to cry out. But as long as we continue this way, we will continue to play our bit, we will continue to do what we are supposed to do, but at the end, if the state assemblies do not concur with our position, it becomes a futility. And I think that is just what is maybe bedeviling the issue of local government or autonomy, because virtually you will have state governors on top of the state assemblies. They always work together, and I don't believe they would want to have a problem existing or emanating between the two arms of government at the state level. Perhaps when we continue to engage them, maybe at the level of Nigeria Governors Forum, part of the engagements we do have with them, at the level of maybe engagements with the local with the state assemblies, I think we'll begin to enlighten ourselves more and begin to see reason why we should allow local governments to operate independently, for us to have an effective local government administration that will impact on the lives of the people. I think even this issue of insecurity, if local governments have been allowed to work freely with enough resources being injected to the system, I believe so many things will have been reduce in terms of insecurity, joblessness among Nigerian youth, because it is from joblessness that you now find people now gainfully going into criminalities. That is my position about that. No, I don't want to by any reason preempt what the result of the electoral act will be, but I want to believe we are trying to be cautious, and there is no point we need to be very cautious as to what we will provide in the Electoral Act, whether that thing is practicable or not practicable. There are so many things that we may want to have in our electoral system. There are so many changes, proactive changes, that we may want to learn from other systems of elections in other countries. But when you come to look at the context of election in our own democracy, the level of development of our own democracy, there are certain things, whether you like it or not, basically may not be able to apply. That is our fear. And I don't think we should allow ourselves be like stampeded into taking an action that at the end will have a very demanding repercussion. Whether you like it or not, we need to develop to the level where we can adopt a system and that system works for us effectively. Not just to begin to cry out, oh, let's have electronic voting, let's have diaspora voting, and at the end, you do not have the infrastructural capacity to really implement such things by way of developments or whatever. Because it's technology intensive.
You appropriated money like two, three years ago for For electronic voting?
No, we have not appropriated money for electoral voting. What we appropriated was for the use of the card reader. The use of the card reader is one thing on one hand, mm-hmm. and the adoption of electronic voting is another thing. The money we appropriated was for the National Electoral Commission to now make use of the card reader. Of course, using card reader is one step forward, mm-hmm. but beginning to now adopt electronic voting is yet another thing. And I want to believe, in my own opinion, that Nigeria needs to get to that point before you adopt it. We need to have that capacity, that technological development. We need to be much more enlightened in terms of technology. We need to know whether actually our people at the grassroots can be able to even do electronic voting. Otherwise, you bring a system that at the end will work against the major system. When you bring electoral voting, for instance, to a place whereby people are not enlightened, they are not educated, they don't know how to vote electronically, then you are now creating a means for people who are enlightened, a few enlightened people, to manipulate our system. We don't want to allow manipulation in a system that we cannot effectively control. I am not foreclosing, like I said, the position of the electoral law, but in my own opinion, that let us get to the bridge before we cross it. In my own opinion is that we should not allow a few individuals who may have advantage of technology, knowing technology very well, very few individuals among us, to employ or bring in a system that can at the end be used against the general interest of the people. This is democracy, and something that is called democracy must be in the larger interest of the larger majority of the people you want to govern through democratic process. Even if the system still sounds to be, primitive, it does not matter, as long as that primitive system serves the majority interest of the people. That is democracy. I think not even as a leader, as a well-meaning Nigerian, nobody would want to even see reasons why Nigerians, or in the name of hoodlums, go and begin to burn down facilities of the INEC, or burn down, INEC offices, either at the state level or at the local government level. Some of them go to the extent of even burning down police stations. A situation going this far, my brother, is to say the least unfortunate. Because you wouldn't expect a well-meaning Nigerian going to burn an office where you have no business with at the moment. And in most cases, these things are happening at a time when there was even no election going on. It was not as if they are doing it aftermath of an election process. In a situation whereby state does not have an election to hold, and you find hoodlums or some sponsored young men going to burn down INEC office or burn down police stations, is to say the least unfortunate. And whether you like it or not, the fact is that this is having political underlining. There are political motives behind it. And whoever is responsible for that, I think, is not being patriotic to the country, and it will not serve any good for him. The fact still remains, those agencies or those infrastructures of government are needed to conduct good elections. When you burn down them, then at the end, what do you have as a result? It's a retrogressive result, and it will not help Nigerians. I don't see any benefit from anyone achieving. You are achieving nothing, actually. You are not achieving anything when you burn down, especially INEC offices, even though, most especially at times when you have no elections going on. You will still revert to the same INEC office for elections. When you burn down their materials, when you burn down their logistics, cars, and what have you, you are putting Nigeria 100 miles behind. And it's still the same Nigerian resources, government money, your own money, your own resources that will be used to replace some of those things that you have burnt down. So it's like you are burning your pocket by yourself, and at the end of the day, you pay for it. I don't even see any good political reason why hoodlums should be engaged or hired to go and burn INEC offices. It is, to say the least, very unfortunate. Quite unfortunate, and I would want to call on Nigerians, especially the youth. The traditional institutions also should find cause to vehemently go against this kind of dastardly actions, because for me, it will not help Nigeria, and it will not help anyone when you now begin to fool down our infrastructure, democratic infrastructure, infrastructures that are basically needed for free and fair election. And even when you burn them down, like I earlier said, you will still need to replace them with the same government resources to be able to function. I think people going into this kind of thing should have a rethink and take it again to remember that we must have to salvage our country, Nigeria, before we progress. We have not taken a position as a party. And you know, I'm a major stakeholder of this party at the national level. I belong to virtually every stage of political, every stage of our party's level of administration. I'm a member of the NEC. I'm a member of the National Caucus. And most so, I'm a member of the tripartite presidential committee on the party itself and the governance of the process of governance in the country. So for me to now make a statement when we have not made a formal statement by the party, I think is to say the least preempting the position of the party. But if you insist, I must say my own opinion. I want to believe that zoning is not a constitutional arrangement. Zoning is only an agreement among stakeholders of the party. And I also a proponent of a zoning formula, zoning arrangement. Because whether you like it or not, we are running a federal system of government. Like I've earlier said, diverse ethnicities, diverse components of the federation. Then when you have an arrangement, whether it's constitutional or not, as long as it does not contravene any straightforward constitutional provision, a system or a formula that helps you to coexist and operate with mutual understanding for mutual benefit of the country itself, then I want to believe we must encourage it. In my own opinion, zoning is a good formula that we must have to continue to adopt. And when a component, one part of the country, plays its bit or has its own turn, then I think it's only fair you allow another part of the country to take its own turn. As long as we don't observe this principle of zoning or this principle of mutual coexistence and believing that, yes, this is one Nigeria for every one of us, one Nigeria that every one of us belongs, with nobody being called or addressed as a super citizen. Everybody is a citizen of the country. I think it's only good if we allow everyone to have his own time, turn, as and when due. So for me, in my own opinion, time has come when we should not consider, we should not think of having power back to the north, because we have taken two terms of this of our own shot. So we now concede power to the other part of the country, whether southwest, south-south, at least to the south, so that we will continue to see ourselves as operating a just system, a system that is devoid of any sentiment or selfish direction, which will actually help us to continue to see ourselves as one country and working together. And any other thing that goes against this, I think, is not only undemocratic, but it is something that will work out against the unity of the country. And I think we need to be united. We need to be responsive. And I think we also need to be responsive to ourselves and keep to the tenets of some informal arrangements in our democratic system. Every country can have this kind of thing. It may not be constitutional, but as long as it helps, it keeps us, it gives us the kind of cohesion we require, then we keep to it, because that will now see to the peaceful coexistence of a diverse country with a diverse realities around us, to be united and continue to operate as one nation and one destiny.